morning, church. Glad to have you here with us this morning. Glad to be together. And we just want to give God thanks for this moment in time when we can just think of Him, give Him praise, give Him glory. Let's just join together, lift our voices, and worship. It's higher than the mountains that I face. It's stronger than the power of the grave. It's constant in the trial and the change. One thing remains. Sing it again, higher. It's higher than the mountains that I face. It's stronger than the power of the grave. It's constant in the trial and the change. One thing remains. This one
Good morning again. Good morning again, Watson Run. We're so glad to see you here, that you have come and decided to worship with us this morning. Couple things I have for announcements. The first thing is Trunk or Treat is going to be this Saturday here at the church from 4 to 5:30. And what it's going to look like is we ask that you consider coming and having your car decorated and passing out candy to the people here in the church. And one thing that we definitely want to stress to you is that we're going to have hot dogs and hot cider. So come, and that can be your dinner, and then you can go trick-or-treat if you decide to afterwards. So 4 to 5:30 here at the church in the church parking lot. If you decide that you are going to pass out candy, we ask that you have take a minute and sign the sign-up sheet there, just so we kind of know on how many people we're looking at and how much candy we need to get. The other thing is Operation Christmas Child. It's kind of crazy to think that we're already there, but we are just wanting to make you aware that the boxes are due November 15th. So November 15th, they will be here at the church. We, as a church, take care of the shipping for you. That is not something that you need to put in the boxes, but more information will be coming here shortly. But just wanted to let you know to put it in your calendar. November 15th, the boxes need to be here. Forge Youth, they are going to meet after this service and lunch is provided. They're going to Sprongs. And then if you have a youth kid, you need to pick them up at 3:15 here at the church. And then offering, there is not an offering plate that will go around. So if you have an offering that you want to give to the church, there is a box in the back that you can place it in. Or behind me, you'll see there's some information on how you can give. You can text to give, go on the website. So go ahead and if that's something you would like to do. And the last, one of the most important things that we want to make you aware of is the prayer and communication cards that's in the chair in front of you or behind you. Those are huge to the church leadership. So what we like to see from you guys is any prayer or praise or anything you want to make us aware of that maybe there's a need, please fill that out, because that's how we can know what's going on in your world and if there's anything that we need to help with and especially pray for. Then my last thing that I'm really excited to announce is, as you know, we have the Growing Together campaign, and that's what we're doing at the new church building. So when we kind of announced this, we kind of felt like, well, man, we wanted to get it to where you guys heard from people in the congregation. We wanted to ask the people in the congregation, hey, what are you most looking forward to in the new building? So we got them together, and we want you to take a look.
Having some more room for the kids to run around, and some maybe community events and Bible study small groups.
I'm excited about the new church building and also for the classrooms. We've been blessed with a beautiful family here, and the kids really enjoy every Sunday morning. They talk about going to Sunday school, and on the way home from church they talk about Sunday school. So I'm looking forward to them having a little bit more space, a little more flexibility on what they're able to do with the new building, with the more space that's going to be available. So we give a shout out to the teachers. You're doing a great job. We've really noticed the difference. On Sunday mornings, it's going to be nice to have a little more room in the sanctuary coming in, just a little more elbow room. We'll probably still sit in the front. I've gotten used to that. So yeah, really looking forward to just everything about it.
So I'm definitely looking forward to the exposure we're going to have out there on Route 322, and the just that people are going to be able to see the church better, stop in, and see what's going on. I'm looking forward to meeting some more new people. So.
I'm glad to be going to a new class, and seeing the new church and stuff.
I'm super excited about having more space to welcome more people able to fellowship better after church.
So not only am I so excited about all the additional parking, we're going to have so much more room to expand all of the ministries that Watson Run offers to the community.
So what I've really been excited for is getting out and working with the the new church, demolishing it down, and help building it back up. And while I'm out there, kind of meeting newer people that I haven't got to see, because they go to second service, or if I miss a couple days, but just meeting new people and helping build the church.
We're really excited for the new classrooms for both our daughter and ourselves. Our daughter is going to have the opportunity to grow through the different grade levels, and then we've both been enjoying going to separate Bible studies, and we've been meeting outside and trying to find various places. So it's going to be really great that we can all be together in classrooms.
I remember when we were just considering buying this property, and now all the hard work that's been done, well, hard work for those with the hammer and nails in their hands. And now that the construction is coming to a close, I just wonder what God's plan is for the spacious room. I know it's a great opportunity for our church to spread God's word, and through God's word, we'll add souls to his kingdom. So when I was asked, what am I most looking forward to? My answer would be, what's yet to come. Not what we have, not what we have acquired, but what's to come.
We're looking forward to more space to watch our church grow.
And I'm looking forward to that.
I'm excited for the new building because I'm going to get to see some new people and there's more room. And
we're excited for a bigger space to host kids night.
I'm looking forward to just having more space and being able to do more fellowshipping and meeting all the people that go to first service that we don't normally get to see. And again, just fellowship and reaching out to the community and having all that space.
I'm looking forward to when we show up just a few seconds late, that we won't have to stand in the back for the first 5 minutes looking for a seat for all of us. So it's going to be great.
Hello, my name is Jim, and I have the great privilege of being in charge of Watson Run Church Sunday School program. I oversee a group of creative teachers who are now going to have much more room to use their creativity in our new building. Our Sunday School classrooms are going to double or sometimes triple in size, more opportunities for the kids to get around, and the teachers to use their imagination, the kids use your imagination, and I'm very excited at what God's going to do with our creative teachers in the new building.
So, I am excited about having enough room that we can do events inside the building and just have a lot of room to learn more about Jesus as a congregation and in a youth group.
Boy, am I excited about the new church out on 322. We've got a bigger parking lot, we've got a bigger building, we've got Sunday school rooms, we've got more space. We're making it a house of worship to the Lord.
So, are you excited? Are you excited for the new building? And we wanted you to see from you guys, that it's going to be an awesome thing, and the Lord is just blessing it. So, one thing that we just want to inform you on is, one is there's work days every Saturday at 9 a.m. And we ask that if you have a Saturday that is free or can just even just a couple hours, if you can help, it doesn't matter your age or if you have kids, there's something for everyone. And it's something that is such a blessing because just being out there yesterday myself and seeing all the classrooms and just kind of envisioning how it's all going to look, it really was kind of emotional and kind of exciting to just see how the Lord's moving in all this. So our main thing that we definitely need from you is prayer. So please keep praying for the building. Keep praying that God just keeps everyone safe that's working on the building, keep their family safe as they're sacrificing all these hours to work on this building. And then the other thing is if you have a minute or a couple hours that you can help and give, please give to the church in that time and working out there. But then also come check it out. I mean, just being in that building is amazing. So consider that in your schedule, please. And then as always, if there's a financial gift that you can give toward it and it's something that you feel like the Lord is calling you to do, please consider on doing that. Would you please worship with us?
Mm-hmm. Church, I want you to know and think with me this morning. God loves you. He loves me unconditionally. Let's just sing some more about His love together. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Your love never fails, it never gives up, it never runs out on me. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for loving us. Sing it out, church. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up. It never runs out on me.
Psalm 16, 5 through 11. It says, "You, Lord, are all I have, and you give me all I need. My future is in your hands. How wonderful are your gifts to me, and how good they are. I praise the Lord because he guides me, and in the night of my conscience warms me. I am always aware of the Lord's presence. He is near me, and nothing can shake me. And so I am thankful and glad, and I feel completely secure because you protect me from the power of death. I have served you faithfully, and you have not abandoned me." So churches, things are kind of going crazy in this world right now. We just want you in this next song just to cling to these words and really pour into worship right now as we sing this song.
Jesus, you can have
hear the Savior say, thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thy all in all. All together, church. For Jesus paid it all, and all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sing it out. For Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain, he washed it white as snow. Sin had left a crimson stain. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Amen, church. Give him praise this morning. Give him praise. Give him praise. You can be seated as we dismiss the kids to go downstairs.
Amen. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. Let's thank the Lord for the worship team this morning. Amen. And Jamie, thanks for coming in on cue with the video. You gotta love it. Anyhow, it's good to be here. I want to thank everybody that took part in making that video, for the growing together. And I want to thank everybody that's been coming out and working so hard. It's been wonderful. Stacy was praying for no injuries. We've had a few injuries out there, a few close calls, but all in all, God's keeping us safe. It's going good, and it's really coming together. I said I'm going to see if the video crew couldn't go out and do a video tour of it right now, because we're really down to a little bit of electrical, and the drywallers will come in, and then it's going to change. Drastically, we're considering a prayer service out there, and just an opportunity for us to go around with Sharpies and write on the studs before it gets covered up with drywall, sort of a prayer of praise, or just for later down the road if it ever gets remodeled, somebody's gonna tear something off and go, whoa, what's all this, we just think it'd be neat. So anyhow, having a lot of fun, a lot of good things happening. The parking's in, the lights are on the outside of the building. The neighbor texted me and said, man, how beautiful it looks. We had the front pressure wash, and it just looks like a new building all of a sudden. It's amazing how dirty it was and how, just years and years of grime that simply pressure washing it came right off. So we're excited. Can't wait to get in there. So this morning, I want to talk to you a little bit about, I think I mentioned. And anyhow, I want to welcome the online people. I keep forgetting to do that, but, those that are still watching us online, welcome. We're glad that you're with us. We're excited about this day. But, I've been on this little bit of a trend here, and I keep telling you about this message that I can't get made small enough or divided into, and it may never happen. I don't know. We'll see what God says. But, there's just enough life situations going on. There's enough things that you and I encounter in life, that forces us into the Word of God, that gives me opportunities, to build a message on. And it's exciting. The last couple of weeks, this what's been on my mind. And DJ, I think you might have a calling. I seen that a little bit in that video. You better pay attention. God might be calling you somewhere here. Anyhow, moving on. but I just keep thinking about joy and rejoicing, and so I started wrestling with this idea of joy and happiness. What's the difference? And that's what I want to look at today a little bit. The title is Rejoicing in the Joy of the Lord. We're going to look at some scripture in Habakkuk. Now you can pronounce that however you want, and I'll be good with it. Some say Habakkuk, some Habakkuk, do whatever you want. That's still up for debate, how it's actually pronounced. But I want to share with you out of the sort of the introduction out of the life application. I want to help you understand. Now, Habakkuk understands a prophet, to Judah, and it's a great little book. I believe it's only three chapters. There's a lot in there, but I want to help you understand a little bit where Habakkuk comes from, so it makes more sense. you know, when we look at the message and sort of think about this rejoicing in the joy of the Lord, from the Life Application Bible, it says, from innocent childhood queries to complex university discussions, life is filled with questions, you know, asking how and why and when, you know, we sort of probe beneath the surface to find satisfying answers, but not all questions have answers that are wrapped up and tied neatly. These unanswered interrogations, you know, create more questions and nagging in our minds, you know, more spirit-destroying doubt sometimes. And some choose to live with their doubts, you know, ignoring them and moving on with life. Others become cynical and hardened, but there are those who reject those opinions or those options and continue to ask, you know, looking for answers. That would describe the person of Habakkuk. Habakkuk was a man, you know, who sought answers. He wanted to know more. He was troubled by what he observed, and he asked, and he started to ask, and what he was observing was, you know, sort of rottenness in society. So he started to ask some difficult questions, and these questions were not merely intellectual exercises or bitter complaints. Habakkuk saw a dying world, and it literally was breaking his heart. You know, so he the questions he would ask is, you know, why is there evil in the world? You know, he's asking God, why is there evil in the world? And why do wicked people seem to be winning in our world? You know, and even, you know, if we're honest, we probably have struggled with those questions a little bit. You know, why is it sometimes that the wicked seem to be, you know, doing better than us at times? And so Habakkuk, you know, he was a prophet, but he was asking some of these questions. And he then boldly and confidently took his complaints directly to God, and God answered. But he answered with an avalanche of proof and prediction. You know, the prophet's questions and God's answers are recorded in this book. You know, as you turn the pages and you read these scriptures, and I think it's, you know, it's just a wonderful book for you and I to get in. A little short book, but there's a lot in there. You know, if we could break down a little bit about today in this message, rejoicing in the joy of the Lord, you know, we can choose, and how many know it really is a choice, we can choose to rejoice in the Lord always by doing a couple things: acknowledging his presence and adopting his perspective in life. Habakkuk 3, I'm going to, chapter 3, verses 17 through 19, follow along. It says, though the fig tree does not bud and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no food, though there is no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, verse 18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of a deer. He enables me to go on the heights. And then Paul finishes up in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. I will say it again, rejoice. The title this morning is simply Rejoicing in the Joy of the Lord. Let's pray before we get started. God, we thank you for this day. God, in another opportunity to gather and to fellowship and to praise you through song and through worship. And God, another day to learn from your word. And this morning, God, as we go back into the Old Testament and look at the prophet Habakkuk, God, let us learn from his life, and let us learn from how he lived his life, and how we see joy in his life, joy like we don't see a lot maybe in our modern day world. So God, just with the help of the Holy Spirit, prepare our hearts this morning to just simply learn from your word. God, we thank you so much for the gift of your son, Jesus Christ. And God, this morning, as we look at this idea, we're going to understand that it's there and only from a relationship with Jesus Christ that we can even begin to understand what this joy really is in our lives. God, help us to see this morning the difference between joy and happiness. God, and how that's played out in our lives every day. God, thank you again just for loving us enough to send Jesus to die on the cross to pay the penalties for our sins. God, if we're going to understand joy, it needs to start with a relationship with Jesus Christ. So God, be with us today as we learn. That's what we pray this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. So I was playing with my phone, and evidently I turned it on, not off. So anyhow, I want to start by telling you there's a little story. Many of you know who Max Lucado is. You know, and he wrote, excuse me, he wrote this book titled The Eye of the Storm. And in this book, he talks a little bit about this bird owner that had this beautiful little bird that sings very well. I shared earlier that, you know, Bonnie and I used to have a bird for many years. We had a little bird. Was it a parakeet, something like that? It talked very little. And we loved that bird and hated that bird at the same time. He was a neat little bird, but he was just an aggravating little thing. So this story, you know, sort of caught my attention. But one day, you know, the pet owner was cleaning out the bird's cage and was vacuuming out the stuff. And when all of a sudden, boom, sucked the little birdie up in the vacuum cleaner. You know, the owner of the bird quickly shut the vacuum off, and you know how you can open up the sweeper and go to the bagger, and maybe we don't have bags and sweepers anymore, but you go to where the dirt is, and he reaches in, he pulls out this little bird and shakes the dirt off, and you know, his initial response was, because this bird was all covered with dust and dirt, was, you know, he rushed this bird into the bathroom and started to rinse him out in the sink. And while, you know, after he got the bird pretty well rinsed out in the sink and he was looking good, he noticed the bird shivering. The bird's actually a little bit, you know, he could tell the bird was cold from the cold water. He should have used warm water. So he grabs a hairdryer and he starts to blast this bird with hot air to dry the bird off. And you know, to make a long story short, you know, the bird survived and he puts the bird back in the cage. And a friend who had heard about the situation called him a couple of days later just to check and see how the bird was doing. And he said, well, you know, the bird's doing all right, but, you know, the bird doesn't sing much anymore. He just sort of sits around and stares. We could say that, you know, the bird lost its joy. You know, how many of you, and even myself at times, how many times have we lost, you know, our joy because of some ordeal in life, you know, because of, and when I mean ordeal, it can be anything, you know, it can be any problem that we face in life. You know, sometimes even with the death of a loved one, you know, some people, you know, lose their joy, you know, sometimes, you know, for days, weeks, months, years. You know, many people, you know, will lose their joy for almost forever. You know, they never really recover from a situation like that. So the question, you know, that I would pose to you today, just generally speaking, are you happy? You know, are you happy? And if I asked that question, many people would say, well, that depends. You know, that really, you know, and we're kind of like that in our lives. You know, that would depend on many things. You know, for some, it would depend on our mood. You know, that would depend on our situation, you know, where we find ourselves at, you know, in this season in life. You know, some would say, well, that depends on the people that we're with. You know, it would depend on some of the things that are happening, you know, in our world around us, that kind of thing. You know, happiness, if you think about it, can be elusive. You know, and we want it. We want happiness. But, you know, even when we get it, sometimes it's hard to keep it. You know, because it, you know, and it's hard to keep it because it depends on what happens to us. You know, depending on what happens to us, that means whether we're happy or not. And, you know, so many times we simply can't control our happiness. And maybe you're happy right now. I don't know. Maybe you're not. Maybe you're wishing this service was over. I don't know. You know, but how many know I could, you know, with one sentence, you know, I could steal your happiness. You know, I say often, I've been in ministry a long time, and I'm only one comment away from upsetting somebody at any given moment. You know, that's the tender world we live in. You know, so somebody or something or some person can steal our happiness almost in an instant. Because happiness is entirely circumstantial, okay? If the circumstances are the source of our joy and they are ever changing, then you and I have no guarantee that this feeling that we have is going to stay. You see where I'm going with this? You know, that's why the Bible almost hardly uses the word happy or happiness. Actually, I think only about 25 times can you find it in Scripture. The Bible doesn't use the word happiness or happy. God chooses instead to use the word rejoice or joy. And there's a reason for it. And actually, rejoice and joy is in the Scripture over 300 times, 320 or 330 times. Because that's what He, being the Lord Jesus Christ, has given us. He's given us joy, not happiness. You know, and each actually spring up from a different source. You know, one comes from the world around me. Happiness comes from the world around me. But joy originates directly from the Spirit of the living God. Two totally different things. Joy is the fruit of the Spirit. We talked about it last week. Joy is a gift from God to you and I. You know, I think the prophet Habakkuk gave the best definition of joy, you know, in the Scripture. He said, no matter what happens around him, he has chosen in verse 18 to rejoice in the Lord and be joyful in God my Savior. No matter what happens around him, he has chosen to rejoice in the Lord and be joyful in God his Savior. Despite all odds, he said, the Lord is my salvation, so it will be well with my soul. You know, it's not that we never get sad, or not that we'll never, you know, be sorrowful, because we do. We get sad and we deal with sorrow. But deep down in our hearts, you know, there is this rested joy, we could say, that all is well with our soul. You know, even in the midst of sorrow, even in the midst of sadness, you know, for the believer, and I would like to say almost, the active believer, you know, there's this rested joy that all is well with my soul. Because the Lord's there, right? Because the Lord's there. You know, excuse me, how many know joy is the evidence of the presence of God in our lives? Joy is the evidence of the presence of God in our lives. Do you know somebody that almost, you seldom ever catch them with a smile on their face? You know, they just never seem to be happy? Hopefully that person isn't a Christian. Hopefully that person isn't a follower of Jesus Christ. So we need to do a couple of things in order to rejoice in the joy of the Lord. One, we need to acknowledge his presence. You know, when we choose to be joyful by acknowledging God's presence, it changes who we are as a Christian. Habakkuk's joy is not dependent on what is happening around him. His joy is in the presence of God in his life. The psalmist says in Psalm 16:11, in his presence there is fullness of joy. So if God is present in our life, then joy can be present as well, right? If God is present in our life, then joy can be present as well. If he dwells in my heart, then my joy can be permanent. If he dwells in my heart, then my joy can be permanent. Bernard Vaughan, an English Roman Catholic priest, wrote one time, the happiness of heart cannot be attained without God, just like light and sunshine cannot be there without a sun. On every side, he said, in every part of the world, men and women are seeking happiness and cannot find it because they do not seek it from God. In other words, there is no lasting joy for you and I apart from God. There is no lasting joy in our lives apart from a relationship with Jesus Christ. What we'll find is only temporary feelings of happiness. You know, we need to acknowledge God's presence, especially you know, during them times in life where we're sad, you know, when we're struggling. You know, and it's not that we don't know. We know, you know, we understand. It's because we're too overwhelmed by our sorrow that we cannot see. You know, we would say that we lose that keen awareness of God's presence in our lives, you know, because we're caught up in something sorrowful in our life. It's like the two disciples, remember on the road back to Emmaus? You know, they were weighed down by the tragedy that just taken place. You know, Jesus had just died, and they were walking along the road, and they're downcast, their chins are hanging down, they're sad. Remember the story? Then Jesus comes up and starts to walk with them. And he's walking along with them, and they didn't even recognize who he was. You know, Jesus then had to remind them of what the scripture said, and then he, you know, Jesus sort of almost rekindles their hope in what God has said. Then all of a sudden, finally, they recognize who it is. And then remember in verse 32 of Luke 24, it says, you know, were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road? It's like they can't even believe it. Something should, and you know, what they're saying is, something should have taken place in my heart. Something, you know, I should have recognized who we were walking with and talking with. You know, they were filled then with excitement, and they rushed back to Jerusalem, which is, you know, called in the scriptures a place of sorrow. You know, when you and I are really down, you know, when you and I are really going through a tough time in life, you know, we really should say, like Habakkuk said in verse 18, yet I will rejoice in the Lord, and I will be joyful in God my Savior. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes my feet like the feet of deer. He enables me to go onto the heights. You know, what does that mean? He makes my feet like a deer. I said earlier, it's, you know, did you ever see a deer run across a plowed field? Any of you guys hunt? You seen it? I mean, you know, we'd stumble and trip, but a deer will just flawlessly run across that field. You know, that's what God's saying to us. He'll give us feet like a deer. We'll be able to, you know, to maneuver through life and the rough patches of life more smoothly. We'll be able to go to higher, you know, heights. You know, he's simply saying, you know, Habakkuk's saying to you and I is that God enables him. You know, it's God, it's Jesus Christ. It's God that enables him, you know, to be who he is and to have the joy that he has in his life. Joy is anchored upon a relationship and not a circumstance. You know, it's anchored in sort of an unshakable and unbreakable relationship with God through Jesus Christ. If the Lord has taken up permanent residence in our heart, in other words, if we've invited him into our heart and life to be our Lord and Savior, then joy can be a permanent feature in our lives. It can be part, you know, we can be known as a joyful person. You know, again, you know, we need to heed what Paul says in Philippians 4:4, rejoice in the Lord always. Rejoice in the Lord always. You know, we can choose to sing praise to him, you know, despite the difficulties that we find ourselves in life. And we do that by faith. You know, we receive his joy by faith. You know, we don't have to wait till the situation is better. We don't have to wait till the circumstances change to have this joy. We simply declare it by faith. You know, by faith in Jesus Christ, we declare it, you know, that God's presence is in our lives and it's in control. And man, when we know God, when we know Jesus is in control of who we are and how we are, you know, we can have some joy. That's the sense we get from David in Psalm 23:4. He listened, and we know the 23rd Psalm. We've all known it and heard it. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, that's, you know, that's sadness, that's trials and tribulations, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. In other words, we don't have to get out of the valley to find comfort and strength. We don't have to get out of the valley to have joy. You know, we don't have to wait for the fig tree to bud. We don't have to wait for the grapes to grow. You know, we don't have to wait for the problems to be solved, for our life partner to appear out of nowhere. You know, we don't have to wait for the loan to be paid off. We don't have to wait for the next promotion at work. We don't have to wait for whatever it is, you fill in the blank. We don't have to wait for that to happen to have the joy of the Lord in our lives. We can choose to trust God, and we can rejoice in the Lord always, and we can allow then the Spirit of God to fill our hearts with joy, regardless of all those other things. Our joy simply comes from the Lord and from a relationship with Him. The second thing we must do is adopt His perspective. We need to adopt His perspective, and I mean His perspective in life, not our perspective. Our perspective is flawed. You know, we need to put things in perspective. We need to put things in His perspective. You know, joy is a destination, or is not a destination, it's a journey. Joy is not a destination, it's a journey. And we have joy because God is in control. When we're in control of our lives, I can almost assure you we don't have joy. When God is in control of our lives, we have joy. You know, and He is not at the end of our problems. Sometimes we believe that God is at the end of our problems. In other words, you know, when everything is settled, when everything is right, you know, when the storms have subsided and gone away, you know, when the problems are solved, you know, when we receive God's answers, you know, to our prayers, you know, we think then and only then do we celebrate and rejoice. No, the truth is God wants you and I to rejoice in Him always. You know, He alone is enough to make us joyful, is He not? And so joy doesn't come at the very end. It comes even in the midst of all the ups and downs in our life. Joy comes even through the good times and the bad times in life. I said earlier, it's like having a, you know, a date with your loved one, you know, whether wife, spouse, whatever. And you take them, you know, you go to a nice restaurant where they got, you know, nice restaurant, nice music playing, nice food. And it's wonderful, isn't it? You know, but what will give you this happy feeling isn't the restaurant, it isn't the food, it isn't the music, it's the person that you're there with. You see, the person makes all the difference. Now, maybe there's somebody here that's more interested in the food than the person that they took there. But listen, there's no end to the troubles that you and I will face in life. You know, after, how many know, after we overcome one problem, you can expect to face another one. You can expect to face another one. I shared earlier, I come out of the world just the most worldly guy you'd ever imagine. Smoked, drank, did everything bad and wrong you could do in life. You know, and I come to know the Lord, and I quit smoking, quit drinking. And every time I did one of those things, you know, I thought, man, I've nailed it. God can really use me now. And guess what? You know, God showed me something else that needed to go in my life. And so I'd work on getting rid of it. And I'm thinking, now I got it. Now there's nothing between me and how I can serve the Lord. And God showed me another thing. You know, I just say over the years, He's still showing me things, but the mountains are smaller. You know, because there's always another mountain for you and I to climb. There's always another mountain for you and I to climb. You know, they may get smaller over the years, but they're going to come. The problems are going to come. But God wants you and I to enjoy the journey. He wants you and I to enjoy the process of you and I becoming more Christ-like in our relationship with Him. He wants us to enjoy the journey, not just the destination. You know, we don't. If I wait till I'm perfect to be joyful, I'm never going to be joyful. We need to be joyful in the process, you know, in the journey, not just the destination. You know, and I'm sure we'll be happy at the end. You know, I'm sure when I get it all figured out, or I'm in heaven with the Lord, I'm going to be happy. But there's joy. You know, the Bible says if we go back to the 23rd Psalm, there is joy in walking through the valley. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil because my God is with me. And if my God is with me, it can be a joyful time in our lives. In Acts 16, the authorities beat up Paul and Silas. We talk about this all the time. You know, Paul is just such a dynamic figure in the New Testament. But in Acts 16, they beat up Paul and Silas and they throw them in jail. Yet, the guards come by and they find Paul and Silas in jail, and they're praying and singing hymns. Understand, praying wasn't used in the context of asking for something. They were praising God is what they were doing in jail. They were praising God and they were singing hymns. Why were they praising God? Because they're alive. They're in jail. There's people in jail that need to hear the message of the cross. They were thankful that they're alive, and they're, even though they're in jail, there's people in here that need to hear about Jesus Christ. They were praising him for that. You know, and some would say, well, you know, I'm sure they look at the onlookers thinking, you know, what's there to rejoice about? You know, why are these guys so happy? Well, think about it. There, you know, there's God, right? There's always God. There's his salvation. There's his grace. There's his love. There's his provisions in our lives. And we could go on and on and on. Listen, our perspective is everything. Our perspective is everything. It reminds me, you know, of a story I read a while back, Matthew Henry, a Bible scholar, you know, from the 1700s, you know, he wrote in his diary after some thieves robbed him and took his wallet. This is what he writes. You know, when you think about perspective, listen to this. You know, he was robbed by a bunch of thieves and they took his wallet. And he said, let me be first thankful because I was never robbed before. You know, he was thankful that that's the first time he'd been robbed. Second, he says, because although they took my wallet, they did not take my life. And third, because although they took my all, it was not much. And fourth, because it was I who was robbed, not I who robbed. It's perspective. It's perspective. You know, we've all heard a number of testimonies over the years of Christians who are disadvantaged, we'll say, or handicapped. You know, Nick, is it Wojcicki? Anybody know Nick Wojcicki? Yeah. He's a guy that was born with no arms and no legs. I mean, he's here and here. A wonderful man of God. You know, and you look at that guy and you watch him speak and you're just amazed. You know, this guy, you know, he's full of joy. He's full of joy. Robert Reed, cerebral palsy. Fanny Crosby, accidentally blind as a young girl. Joni Erickson Tata, paralyzed in a diving accident. You know, when you watch those people, they just, you know, we, the common trait I believe you see in them is you see joy. They're joyful. They're always smiling. And listen, they got it rough. And they and not only are they joyful and smiling, but they gave their life to serve the Lord. You know, one would look at them and say, why are they so happy? Well, you know, why are they so happy? I believe the challenges that they face led them to appreciate God more deeply. To be honest, you know, I think they treasure the presence of God in their lives more than we do. I mean, if I could be completely honest. You know, they needed God. Not that we don't. We need God as well, but normal people, if I could call us normal, because none of us are really normal, you know, normal people like us, in other words, not disadvantaged or handicapped or something like that, you know, normal people like us sometimes take God for granted, do we not? You know, we feel that we can help ourselves, and that's the way sometimes we go through life. You know, that may also explain why they are more joyful than many people. You know, they have this acute sense of God's presence in their life. They need him. They feel that touch of God. They feel God's love. They feel his grace in their lives, you know, probably more than other people do. We, on the other hand, think about this. You know, we tend to rely more on ourselves, don't we? We rely on ourselves. We rely on our own efforts. You know, we rely on us to get us out of situations in life. We rely on ourselves to bring joy into our lives. You know, we'll go out and try to figure out how to be more joyous, and really, it's already in us. It's the Spirit of God living within us. You know, what is it that they see that we don't? You know, I believe they see the hand of God in every situation in their lives. They're dependent on God. They need God. They want God. And listen, we can do that as well. We can rejoice every day of our lives because God is in charge if we let him be. We don't understand all of his thoughts. We don't understand all of his ways. Sometimes we don't understand his call in our life. But one thing we can know for sure, we can trust him. We can trust him. The Bible says he's trustworthy. And if we're simply willing to trust him and have a relationship, you know, I shared earlier, people need to, I think people don't understand what a relationship with Jesus Christ looks like. Bonnie and I have a relationship. That means we talk, you know, we love each other, we do things together, you know, we laugh, we joke, you know, we just have, that's what a relationship with Jesus Christ is supposed to look like. You know, we need to learn everything we can learn about him. We need to dialogue with him daily. We need to laugh with Jesus. We need to cry with Jesus. We need to go places with Jesus. We cannot do that if we got dust on our Bibles. We have to understand the scripture. We have to know who Jesus is. That's what a relationship with Jesus Christ looks like. And I'm telling you, when we build that relationship with Jesus Christ, we'll understand what real joy is in our lives. You know, I said to a person, not too long ago, my mom passed, and at the funeral home, you know, an individual, come in there, and you know, the typical, hey, you know, sorry for your loss and all that. And I said, you know, and I just said to this person, I said, I'm so happy for my mom, you know, and he looked at me like, you know, like I'm some sort of heathen, you know, and I kind of a little bit shared with him what I meant, and later he called me, he said, what do you mean by that, you know? Well, I mean, look at the scriptures. Look what the Bible says about eternity with Jesus Christ. You know, yeah, I would love nothing more than to have my mom here. But that wasn't in the cards, you know. But I know she's with Jesus Christ right now, and I am so happy for my mom, for where she is right now. And I'm telling you, you can only understand that, you can only figure that out if you have a relationship with Jesus Christ and you have some semblance of God's joy in your life. So as we wrap up this morning, but here's the thing. You and I, if we have the joy of the Lord in our heart, if we're living out that joy, God's joy in our lives, we need to go and make other people happy. That's really what it's all about. In a minute, we're going to play an old song for you. It's a children's song. I thought maybe we'd do a kid's song so we could really get it, right? How many know every week, I don't know, at least for me, you know, there's some worship song we sing every week that gets stuck in my head throughout the week, right? I think this is going to be the one, okay? Not taking anything away from the worship team. But this is an old kid song. It says, the joy is the flag flown high from the castle of my heart. Joy is the flag flown high from the castle of my heart when the king is in residence there. And then it says, so let it fly in the sky, let the whole world know. Let it fly in the sky, let the whole world know that the king is in residence here. You know, when we have Jesus in our heart and we have an active, growing relationship with him, you and I will, there's this radiance of joy that comes out of our lives. You can't explain it. We can't understand it, but other people see it. And I'm telling you, if we have Jesus in our heart, we have the joy of the Lord in our heart, people need to see that. We need to spend our time on earth, you know, making other people happy. Listen to this little video when we play it.
World.
I was going to sing it, but I thought we better look for a video. So if joy flows from us, not to us like happiness, right? Joy flows from us. Happiness flows to us. If joy flows from us, then we can make someone else happy, right? We can bless someone with the joy of the Lord that's overflowing out of our lives. You know, we can bless someone with the joy of the Lord that's in our hearts, you know. And why don't we do that more? Why don't we do that more as Christians? Because we should. We should. If you're here this morning and you're not a Christian yet, man, you'll never understand the joy of the Lord apart from a relationship with Jesus Christ. So if you're here this morning and you're not a Christian yet, you need to be one. That's where it starts. I just plainly need to say you need to be a Christian. You need to, and what I mean by a Christian, you need to invite Jesus Christ into your heart and your life to be your Lord and Savior. You can never have the joy that the Bible talks about without knowing God through Jesus Christ. And you can only know him through that relationship with his son, Jesus Christ. Pray and acknowledge Christ as your Savior and invite him into your life. You know, God loved you enough to send Jesus to die on the cross, you know, to pay the price for your sin, to make a way for you and I to come to God. All we got to do is believe it. And if you're a Christian and there isn't much joy in your life, you know, you need to reconnect with Jesus, simply. You need to reconnect with Jesus. And the best way for you and I to connect with Jesus is through the scriptures. You know, ask God for the faith to see him in your life. You know, the joy wanes and disappears when we drift from him and when we take our eyes off of him. That's why I say to have a relationship with Jesus, it's just like the one I have with my wife. I'm in communication with him daily. We are one-to-one daily in my relationship. You know, so read the word. Spend time in prayer. You know, be in church on Sunday morning or Saturday night or whenever it is. And remember, most importantly, joy is the evidence of the presence of God in our lives. You know, what the world wants to see from you and I out in our world, they want to see joy. Not necessarily happiness. They want to see real joy. Let's pray. God, we thank you for this day. God, for this opportunity. God, for each person here this morning. And God, truly, if there's someone here today that doesn't know you as Lord and Savior, they need to take that step. God, they need to invite you into their heart and into their life. They're never going to understand what the joy of the Lord is without a relationship with you. God, just help them to know and understand that you love the world so much that you sent your son Jesus to die on the cross, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Just believe that is true and invite Jesus to come into your heart and into your life to be your Lord and Savior. Then and only then can you start to understand what the joy of the Lord is. And God, if there's somebody here this morning and they are a Christian, they've invited Jesus into their heart, but they're just not experiencing this joy, God, may they reach out to you and ask you to help them to have more joy in their lives, God. And that really starts with us wanting more of you in our lives. God, thank you for today. Thank you for each person here, their willingness to come and to be a part of this service. God, thank you for all that you do in our lives, for all that you do in this church. God, and we just pray that again this week as we go out into the world that you would help us to just love and serve those around us. God, help us to show the joy of the Lord to the world around us. God, if we simply do that, you'll give us opportunities to share the message of Jesus Christ. God, thank you again for this day. This is what we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
refuge in the storm. And through these trials, you've always been faithful.
Again, everyone, thanks so much for being here with us this morning, and we hope that you have been blessed by our time together. We hope you leave here filled with the Word of God, the promises of God, and with the joy that is only found in Him. And as always, we hope that you have a great week, everybody. God bless you.